We went real deep with this one.
All that stuff you don't really hear or appreciate in the mix, but you feel it.
It didn't make the cut.
But it affected Michael and affected the other musicians when they heard it and they played into it.
That's why I label Quincy as the genius he is.
You went a little flat there.
Yeah, you did.
You want to hit record, we should auto-tune that.
Right. Exactly.
You don't want the strings covering all that up. It very well could have gone that way, right? But then it's softer. Live from Los Angeles, the 36th Grammy Award. That's that kind of music, right? It's too lush.
And for all you guys that don't know, Rod Temperton is a white guy.
Well, I think this gave it away here. Pretty sure the secret's out now. Come too far to turn back now. Think of all the things we've been through. Oh, I'm in love with the hustle, hustle. Let's take a listen at those strings.
Oh, man. This is the magic to the song right here. Even the stuff that they didn't use.
This is the prime example. There's like beautiful stuff that'll never be heard that could have been his own work of art on its own.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's dirt.
That's not in the song.
Right?
That didn't make it. That didn't make the cut. That's in there.
It's like a movie soundtrack.
That's in there.
Well, that's the sound of disco from the late 70s, right? It's sort of like the Philadelphia sound, where they really did a lot of the strings.
Did a lot of that in the Philadelphia sound.
Yeah.
They didn't have the strings in the first verse. They brought them in for the second verse.
So they started small and went bigger, but they recorded it throughout. I never heard all those little harmonies.
And we can ride. I want to ride with you. Dance you in today. I want to ride with you. We gonna ride the night away.
Batman. This could be a record by itself.
Bring that chorus.
Alright, hold on. I didn't label this up yet.
Dance you in today. I wanna rock. If you can, solo one of the strings. That's the point out. They didn't use these.
It's got the lower strings on this one.
So we can ride forever.
You went a little flat there.
Yeah, you did.
We should put auto-tune on that.
In song,
if you want to hit record, we should auto-tune that.
Right. Exactly. But if you hear the song, shit, what he did.
Yeah, there are like five or six tracks of strings here.
Yeah. It's one particular one that I love that they didn't use in the bridge. I wanna rock with you, girl.
We're missing some strings.
Rock with you, rock with you. Yeah. Dance the night away. I wanna rock with you. Yeah.
That didn't make the song.
Rock you in today.
Those are.
I wanna rock with you.
That's like a whole other song.
That didn't make it.
That should be a remix. All the things that didn't get put in.
Cellos didn't make it.
Rock you in today.
Like that could be the genesis of the remix.
Rock the night.
But there's some pad strings missing too.
Yeah.
Dance you in today. I wanna
dance
you in today. I wanna rock with you. We gonna rock the night away.
Listen to this.
And when the groove's dead and gone.
Yeah. All the counter melodies.
Hey. That's why I label Quincy as the genius he is.
All that stuff you don't really hear or appreciate in the mix, but you feel it.
It's not in the record. The part that I'm talking about, it didn't make the cut.
But it affected Michael and affected the other musicians when they heard it and they played into it. That was the reaction.
Yeah, they did. Man, play it one more time. I need the viewers.
I wanna
understand this, man.
Right.
This is the kind of stuff that feel. Listen to this, people. Listen to this.
And when the groove's dead and gone, yeah, you know that love's
hard. Hey.
So we can rock on the
fire. Now, that section is mixed with what they kept, with what they didn't keep.
Okay.
You can kind of hear that it's two different.
Yeah, it's like a counterpoint. Da, da, da.
The ones that I like are do 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 do. Which ones are these?
And when the groove is dead and gone, yeah, you know that love.
Those didn't make it.
So we can rock.
But you know, it was a different song then.
Play it again. I love those though, man.
Right there. Hold on.
Listen to this. This is the kind of stuff that makes us as producers lose our minds.
And when the groove is dead and gone, yeah, you know that love's alive.
Did I hear that?
We can rock.
It's like a movie soundtrack there.
Okay, so mute those and do the ones that they did keep.
I think it's these three. Let's see.
Rock the night away. And when the groove is dead and gone, yeah, you know that love survived. So we
that kind of fits more
with
kind of fits. If I get it.
Plus, on top of all the other stuff that's going on there, too.
Rock the night away.
I get it. It also changes the mood.
Right. You don't want the streets covering all that up. It very well could have gone that way, right?
Yeah.
But then it's softer. It's not Studio 54 when you bring all the strings to that level.
Right.
It's movie right. soundtrack.
Right.
Yep. It says, live from Los Angeles, the 36th Grammy Award. That's that kind of music, right? It's too lush.
The whole thing is Michael wanted everybody to do the rock. It was a dance called The Rock.
Okay.
And he literally wanted, like, it's crazy, right? Because I want to rock with you on one hand is I want to hang with you all night.
Right.
So that's the romantic part about it. But the double entendre about it is there was a dance called The Rock. And whenever this record came on, I remember my mama, my uncles, I remember all of them. Whenever this record would come on, everybody would rock. Like, so just imagine, like, synchronized swimming. Imagine that it's in the club. I was way too small to see what it looked like in the club. But whenever family would come over to the house and this record would come on, you would see my older relatives in their different, wherever they were in the house, and it come on and they would all just start rocking. It was a dance called The Rock. I want to rock with you.
And that was the function of the record, and that's what drove the decisions. Like, we spent, think of the money it spent for that. They spent to get the best musicians, the best string players in LA to come out and play those strings. How long it took Quincy to write the arrangement, to rehearse them, and still go, you know what? It's not right for the song. It's out.
I mean,
right? Because he's not suffering from what they call a sunk cost fallacy. Just because you spent some time and money on it doesn't mean it's right.
Yep.
In fact, you're better off having gone through the process of eliminating that decision because you went through it, you heard it, like you were saying about all the permutations. Yeah, I went through those permutations you're asking me about. It didn't work. But here, let me hold your hand. Let's do another day so I show you why it doesn't work. Or trust me and let's get this record done on time. Let's look at the horns then. They start creeping up here in the verse, I think. Well, actually, they kick off at the beginning, right?
See, that's not in the song. That's not in the official release. Just drums.
I didn't recognize that. I'm like, huh, it must be buried in the mix somewhere.
In the beginning of the song, it's just...
So they bailed on. They would say, "Hey, we're not going to go that jazzy," but it could have been a whole different vibe there.
Yep, and that was some of Michael's argument. Too jazzy. Mm. That was actually some of the pushback on Michael using Quincy. That Quincy was too jazz.
He's a Frank Sinatra guy. I want a dance record.
That was some of the pushback, and Michael fought for Quincy. He was like, "If it's not Quincy, I'm not doing it." Off the Wall is really a big, funky, disco jazz album. If you listen to it, there's so much jazz principles in this album. Even when it gets to the bridge part, it turns into like a scat.
I think it's firing up here. Yeah. I'm just kind of playing off Michael's vocals here, I think, too.
We're gonna rock the night away.
Right before we were supposed to tape this episode, and I was having this conversation because there's a record. I sent him a record, and Atazio wrote it.
Okay, yeah.
And they're thinking, they're already thinking number one, man. We got to get a number one out of this. But right now, it's just the skeleton track. And a skeleton vocal. It's still a lot of what Rod is doing right now. You know what I'm saying? And he's already telling me to add this and add that. And it's like, bro, like, can we finish what this is first? And then I'll know how to finish the product. Like, as producers, we don't listen to the vocal as just a vocal. It's an instrument on the record. So can we let that instrument do everything it needs to do? Because whatever track is there, when the vocalist does what they do, it may not need anything else. That may have filled in any other holes it might have had in the record.
That's a good point.
And if not, pinging off of what the vocalist did, I'll know what else to add to finish this record.
And it's a big difference between the scratch vocal and the final vocal.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's just a scratch. Can we finish it first?
Speaking of, this is Rod Templeton. Yeah, Temple. This is the scratch vocal he did, right? Let's see. Oh, let me pull it up here. I got it muted.
I'm falling and na na na.
Right?
Ba na na na. Ba na.
I'll put a little drums in it for him just to help him out. But geez,
yeah,
Louise.
Yeah. The drums.
And he doesn't know any lyrics, right? He's just suggesting lines and whatnot at this point.
And people took. See, it didn't have the. And we don't ride the boogie. That's not in there yet. That was added after Michael was like, yeah.
So just think about the level of imagination you gotta have. It's like, all right, this is just a little guidepost for Michael here.
And for all you guys that don't know, Rod Termperton is a white guy.
Well, I think this gave it away here. Pretty sure the secret's out now.
Rod is cold, man.
Yeah, well, I kid.
a lot of heat wave stuff, all that heat wave stuff.
But it's the genesis of the song. It's sort of like that scene from the Ray Charles movie where what's the guy's name? The Turkish guy that was running the record company. Erdogan. There's a scene where he has an idea for Ray. It's just like a little blues, and he sings it really square and white. And then Ray goes, okay, I got it now, and puts his whole feel on it. But it helped, right? It was like, I'm going to nudge you this way. I know I can't do it because I'm a record executive. I'm not the singer, but this is what I think you should do this. And then take it and do your thing with it. And sort of like you were saying on James Brown and the drummer chemistry. Like a good chemist knows, like, I can't make this explode, but let's get some potassium and some sodium and let's see what happens here, you know?
Put all the substance in there.
Right.
And get that right compound.
Apply some heat, you know? So that's what it took to get the melody in there. And then Michael just puts his own thing upon it, apparently. You know, obviously. Changes the feel. Took liberties with the rhythm, the ride. But the notes are there. And this is pretty much straight up what Rod was doing in the original. And that was all there in the scratch vocal.
Yep. It's all there. This was my argument with the executive. Like, we only in this phase of the record. I'm 1,000% sure Quincy didn't add any strings until the vocals were done.
Right.
Because now he knows how to play off of Michael. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, us as creatives, trust what we're doing, because look, I made the track. So I know what I have before you do. I wouldn't have let you hear it if I didn't think this was potentially something. I have a drive full of stuff nobody's ever heard. I stopped working on it because I didn't have that. I wasn't catching.
It wasn't connecting, right?
wasn't connecting. So I stopped. But that doesn't mean one day I'm in this kind of mood, and if I go back to it, I know how to finish it now.
Or you're like, hey, that was potassium. I finally got some sodium. Let's put that together now. Yeah.
See what we can create. Exactly. You know, so I think a lot of today's executives lack what the older guys had is let these guys finish their creation.
Mm.
Because now the same thing is going on today, at least with me, that was going on back then. Quincy didn't want to hear nothing an executive had to say.
Frank Zappa had some good stuff to say about this. And Frank Zappa, if you don't know, is this amazing band leader, modern composer of the 20th century, hippie weird dude, all the above, but just an amazing artist. He always said the record executives back then were like old fat guys with cigars being like, I don't know, let's just throw it against the wall, see what sticks. Let the kids do what they do. But then over time into the 80s, the kids that were in the mailroom became the executives, and they started saying, well, you know, maybe we should like focus group this, and we should apply these principles on the spreadsheet to replicate the past success. And we'll have an 86% chance of success if we do those things, as opposed to like, screw it, just experiment and we'll know.
So who changed that?
What changed that?
Jimmy Iovine.
Mm.
Jimmy Iovine is that one, that executive that changed that. So everybody is essentially trying to be Jimmy and Clive Davis, because those were two executives, especially Jimmy, because Jimmy comes from the creative side of it. Jimmy knew how to put records together as a creative. He had that in his head. So as an executive, it ain't gonna go nowhere. I can still hear what can make this record go crazy. He just had a penchant to be able to put great ideas together and make them hits as an executive.
Hmm.
The later executives, a lot of them don't come from the creative side.
They're from just the sales, out accounting, ideas. Whatever. Yeah.
You know what I mean? And Clive, I don't think Clive came from the creative side, but Clive was still another visionary. If you ain't a visionary, this ain't, because us as creatives, we're visionaries in the first place. So the we have to pair along with executives that are also visionaries. You don't have to come from the creative side, but if you're a visionary and you can see that this lump of coal is a diamond already, you're a great executive. You're the kind of executive I want to work with. But if you're trying to be the kind of executive that just wants to put his name on something and say he had something to do with making this do what it do, I don't want to work with you.
It always floors me how like how many times I've run into a creative executive that had very little imagination. Yeah, they just want to replicate what's come before 5% more effectively or whatever. But I knew these producers, I'm not going to name names, but they would actually leave one crazy element, like a red herring, like a hi-hat that obviously didn't fit in the mix. And I was helping them. I was like, why are you leaving that in there? Like, that's because when he hears it, he'll get to say, take that one thing out. The rest is perfect. He won't mess with the rest of the mix. I'm like,
genius.
That's some 48 laws of power kind of stuff going on there, right?
It's kind of genius. I'm putting it in there off on purpose so
one,
he can say,
one he'll obviously one bad state. Element. Playing mind games with the executives.
Oh, what? That's I might do that. Hey, if you take this out, I think we got it. Yeah, I already knew that anyway. And see, that's what they don't understand about us. Us as creatives, there's a million things going on in our head when we're making this track. And your one idea, that's probably one of the million and 100 I've come across. Yeah, I've considered that.
Right.
But there's also 999,000 ideas going with that one idea. Let me sort through all of my ideas and I'm going to make it perfect.
Right.
You can take your one idea and just hold off. Just wait. I thought of that because that what you thought about is the obvious. Yeah.
Right.
But us as creatives, we don't always want to do the obvious. How can we attack this from another direction and still make it cool? Now, sometimes I do want to do something. Yeah, I'm not going against the grain. Let's make everything in this obvious. Because it just feels good.
Right.
But I don't always want to start the record with the hook. Mm. I don't always want to do that. I don't always want to do this line because 50,000 other people did that one line. Let me take that one line that you want and figure out a new way to do it. Give me that luxury. Give me that space to do that. Trust me, when I turn it in, it's going to be good.
There's a meme going around, like the $50 client is like, look, you and me are about to embark on a journey that's going to change our lives. And I just need you to really understand the depth of how important this is to me. And the $50,000 client's like, yeah, I'll take mix number two. Right? So there's something to that. Like, you know, as you get higher up the food chain, that trust relationship is there. And that, I'm not sure which is the chicken and the egg, though. I mean, that's just the nature of business in general and relationships in general, right?
All starts from trust. If the artist trusts the producer, we going to get some hits. If the artist trusts the producer, we're going to get some hits. If the executive trusts the producer, we going to get some hits. If you're trying to force your weight on me because you got the power to say no go with this record, which you really don't, because if the artist like that record, that artist is going to overrule you. So my trust is with the artist. If me and the artist have that trust, whatever me and the artist did is going to overrule your say anyway.
Unless it's one of those deals like, well, he fit the suit, so we're going to make this kid a star kind of deal. But yeah, you know, that's the music business.
That's the music business.
Writ large.
And, you know, I'm the guy. You know, some of the little homies saw that and started speaking out against executives at Atlantic Records. I'll say Atlantic Records, you know, people can, it was a big thing, so I'm sure everybody can figure out who that producer is. But a lot of times young producers think it's all about them. And it is. It's your moment. It's your time. But as you weave your way through this thing, you're going to start finding out that these executives want to start taking some of your credit for what you do. But you've already been doing it. But now that you're doing it, it's levels to this. Now that you're doing it at this level, they want to have some say in, yeah, I put this guy with this guy. And yeah, this was my whole baby. When 10 times out of 10, it wasn't, because us as the producers, we have relationships with better relationships with the artists than the executives do. So the artist is going to trust us anyway. But they started speaking now that they saw what I've been seeing for a long time already. They arrived to the same point that I arrived at. Man, these executives need to sit down sometime. Let the process happen.
I mean, a lot of what happens in the engineer chair is psychology and hand-holding the client till they get to that point. And that's sort of the game in the studio, right? It's just like managing that kind of stuff. Like,
even what we're talking about right here with MJ. The guy that signed him was signed to Jackson's, and it was brilliant. He signed to Jackson's to get to Michael, basically. The executives, the higher ups, said the Jacksons, oh, they're dead. They're
yesterday's news. Blah, we're not doing family bands anymore.
They're done. This A&R was like, look, I think Michael Jackson. I think this kid can be one of the biggest stars ever. Like, trust me. And the guy gave him the keys to it. If he didn't trust him, we don't get Michael Jackson. We don't get Off the Wall. We don't get Thriller. We don't get Bad. We don't get Dangerous. We don't get these albums because that executive blocked the process of what that A&R saw in Michael. We don't get it. I mean, you can't stop Michael from being Michael, but do we get Off the Wall, Thriller, Bad, and Dangerous if this guy doesn't trust that process? Do we get that?
Can't say what we do.
And even with even when it came down to that, okay, the A&R wins that argument with his boss. But then the same A&R tries to block Michael from working with Quincy. Quincy's too jazz. He's past his time. He's done. Michael stands up for Quincy. Trust me. We need Quincy on this. He can give me what I need. Okay. I trust you, Michael. We're going with Quincy. Trust. I didn't get to where I am for not knowing what I'm doing. I haven't.
And maybe that's the
element. I got to where you for not knowing what you're doing.
And maybe that's the element that's missing out of records that aren't great, like Rock With You. Trust. All right? There's trust. Do what you do, bass player. Do what you do.
It's all trust.
Key player.
It's
just,
all trust.
Just, I want it kind of this direction, but you do you. Bring it up at the end. I'm going to let you go.
It's all trust. Every musician in that studio session was handpicked by Quincy because he trusts them. Bruce Wadeen is handpicked by Quincy because when they started working together, that became his guy. He never did anything without Bruce Wadeen. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So working with you, I trust you. I don't get in your way. I let you be Thunder Dan. Sensei, do what you do. You already see the direction. I may paint a picture before you touch anything. This is what I'm looking for. And you give it to me. I don't have to question what you're going to do. Matter of fact, you make it difficult because you do so many different takes and all of them are good. It's like, man, how can I use? And this is what we're hearing with this off the with Rock With You. There's multiple takes of the strings, and they're all good.
Right, and they just had to pull it back. They just pulled the reins back a little bit.
Pull the reins back a little bit, and whichever one makes sense for the song, that's the one we're going with.
Right.
But all of them would have made sense, every single last one of them. So it probably came down to the groove of what we're doing. Like, we want this record to really feel like,
remembering the,
I want to dance you in today.
The whole reason the record existed. Just remember the whole idea. And you wanted those flavors, but you didn't want to take over the dish. Yeah.
The whole idea. And, you know, the great thing about multi-track recording is if an idea don't work, take it out. But what we don't want to do is not record it and then second guess later when the album ain't doing nothing. Man, we should have did this. So let's do that. Let's get these ideas out. And whatever isn't conducive to what we're doing on the song, take it out.
Yeah.
I know when I have a hit and I know when I just have a record. Quincy Jones knows when he has hits.
And just think,
Jackson knew when he had a hit.
And part of that deal is there was a pyramid of other songs they built on that you'll never hear. And that one thing at the apex was the hit. And that's below the water. That's just the tip of the iceberg. The rest, all the stuff that didn't quite work, but was an idea, we'll get to it later. That's the foundation that song was built on.
Shake Your Body Down to the Ground. Same record that we talked about before that was inspired by the Bee Gees. The label and the powers that be thought that record was a flop. Wasn't a hit. Didn't have a hook. Is just a bunch of music that make you dance. And see, this is what executives don't understand, especially in the urban space. You're not always going to hear the hit in it the way we do, because there's an extra element in it you ain't factoring in. We made this record to make people dance in Studio 54. We ain't necessarily thinking radio with it. We're thinking the club. And because it works in the club, it's going to bounce out of the club onto radio. Mm. Radio is the afterthought.
Especially nowadays.
The first thought is I want everybody to dance to this record in Studio 54. So your traditional standards of what makes a record a hit flies out the door, because you don't go to Studio 54 the way I do. Which was why my record, I tested my record in the club. I used to take all my records to the club and see the true reaction of how they felt about the record in the club. So now my backing is the people. You can't tell me all these people was wrong. You can't. You in an office and you stay in the office all day or work from home or go to an island somewhere on vacation with your wife and your kids. You ain't in the field like us creatives. We're out here with the people that's going to say they like this record. We with them. I'm one of them. You can't tell us. So shake your body down to the ground. The radio guy, the label's telling them it's not a hit. All right, well, white label it, put it out there, see what it does. The radio guy calls back. Yeah, how's the record doing out there? Shake Your Body is a smash. Michael and his brothers told you it's a smash. They know. They knew. They knew what that record was.
And maybe that's the three-legged pyramid of trust that has to happen. The money
you
element.
You have to have that trust, man.
The producer sophistication element, and then just the raw street level element. They all three got to be in balance for something to have that foundation, right?
You got to have that trust. Let's take Nirvana. Smells Like Teen Spirit. Kurt. And I'm sure when he did that record, he knew he had something. He knew he had something. They didn't realize the impact that record was going to have. They thought it's cool. He played it for his mother. Mom, I want you to hear something. He played it for his mother. And his mother was so astonished by that record, she just looked at her son, Kurt Cobain, in amazement and told him, you have to prepare for what's coming. Because this record is phenomenal. This record is... And Kurt's just looking at it like, we got a good record. I like it. It's cool. And look, me, as a young teenager, when I heard that record, I lost my mind. Smells Like Teen Spirit? I lost my mind. Me and my brother Keyboy, my brother Larry, my little brother Meef, we lost our mind.
It killed metal as a pop music genre, basically.
It did, probably for the better,
because it was a pop metal. Don't get me started. Because that was back when I had really long hair and I played all these progressive metal stuff.
It did kill it.
Grunge overnight. Guitar solo, well, you can do that, but not like you were doing with the Wheedly Wheedlies and the spandex and the... You know, it killed a whole genre of music off like almost overnight.
Hits don't come from radio. Hits come from the streets. Hmm. And sometimes executives lose sight of that. They want to go straight to radio, and a lot of those radio records don't stand the test of time because they don't have that co-signing from the streets. They don't have that oomph.
They're not grounded in the culture.
They're not grounded in the culture. Perfect. They're not grounded in the culture. Smells Like Teen Spirit started in the street. young white kids were losing their minds over this record. That bled over into the urban community. We were loving that record. The first time I saw that record on MTV, me and my brothers were looking at it like, what the fuck is this? Because, and you know what? It's crazy. Because I found out from, what's his name? Dave Grohl. Found out from Dave Grohl. And this is gonna mess you up. This is gonna mess you up, Sensei.
Okay.
I found out from Dave Grohl. The meat of Smells Like Teen Spirit is the Gap Band.
I think I heard this.
The drums that he's, the way he's playing the drums, because the Gap Band used to start a lot of their songs with
right. It all comes full circle, man. And like,
remember what you said about good artists borrow, great artists steal. You might take something and do it your own way. One of the Gap Band's biggest records started off titu. Dave Grohl does it.
He just flips it around. Turn the beat around. Put his own little stamp on it.
Gap Band. He loved the Gap Band's drummer. But he put that. He put elements of funk and R&B in a grunge record, which grunge rock. The basis of rock is blues anyway. He put that element in that record. I didn't hear that.
That's what gave Nirvana that life, right?
That's what gave him that.
That
Dave Grohl
kind of pushing and pulling between punk rock and funk.
But they're all punk rock and funk is related. They're related. They're like country cousins.
City Mouse and Country Mouse kind of thing.
You know what I mean? So they're related. So it at the end of the day, it makes sense when you put it all together. And I think that's we should do a reaction to if we can get the files that Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Man. Yeah, let's see if we can do that. That'd be great.
Yeah. Man, look. That's one of my all-time favorite records right there, too.
And I love this. And, like, the one thing I really want to, like, do with this, I would love to do, I mean, it's a high aspiration. We've only done a handful and whatever. It's, like, see how music, not only what great music is, but how it pulls people together. Yeah. It's enough division in the world and in music, and they always segment it down by demographics and race and geography. But there's something about great music that pulls people together to that universal thing.
Which is why I like what we're doing, because we have me, a black guy, on one side. We got you, a white guy, on the other side. Our love of music.
I'm white.
Well, I mean, you know, I never knew. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, it just, I could have easily done this with another guy from the hip hop side of things. You could have easily done this with a guy who has a rock background, and it would have been cool. But us working together bridged the gap. Us having an appreciation of music. There's hip hop and R&B and funk that you like. There's rock and rock that I like.
Yeah, run both kinds, rock and rock.
You know what I mean? But not only just that, there's country I like, there's country you like,
right? There's 95% of everything is crap, but the 5% greatness everyone appreciates and understands. Everyone loves Dolly Parton,
period.
Right,
period. Well, it's other reasons why they love Dolly Parton, but
the reason she lasted. They love
Dolly Parton is dope.
Right. And they may not like anything else in the country genre, but they can, like, almost universally say, oh, man, You know, and she crossed over. Some of her biggest hits went to R&B.
Yeah. And look, might be like her biggest record of all time. It didn't become a smash when she did it. When Whitney did it, it went crazy. I Will Always Love You.
She took it and put her own spin on it, right? She stole
it. Put her spin on it.
But she stole it creatively.
That's the appreciation of music. When you leave a mark on something, somebody's going to appreciate it and go back to that, pick it up, reinvent it. Well, I ain't going to say reinvent. Well, yeah, reinvent in their way.
Well, how about evolves? Like music evolves. And like natural selection, if it changes and doesn't connect, it just falls off.
But right.
If it mutates the right way, it becomes a whole other species of music.
Right. You know, Rick James didn't like rappers, but it was a rapper that brought back one of his biggest records, or his biggest record, and made it bigger than what it was when he did it. The generations that hate the new, like I don't think I can ever get in a situation where I don't like whatever the youth is doing. My gripe with the youth is, man, learn this stuff the way we learned it, man. Like some of these artists, how me and you can say their names and them not necessarily being who we grew up with. They're our parents' generation, but we know them.
Right.
That's my one gripe with today's artists. Like, they don't know a lot of this stuff and where it comes from. They think it's all about them. Like they're doing something new. You're not. The producers might not be able to tell you where something came from, but they at least have the ear to hear the greatness in something. And then they pick it up and they elevate it, like you said. But, you know, the artist, Michael Jackson was great because he respected all the artists that came before him. He knew who they were. He studied them. You want to be great, study the greats. He knew who they were. You and I, we didn't grow up with somebody like I couldn't stand James Brown when I grew up. He wasn't my guy. But hip hop gave me an appreciation of James Brown and made me go back and study him.
Well,
and because of that, it made me go back and study all these other artists.
It's not a linear progression. You get to a place, then you're like, well, how'd they get to there? And you backtrack like a detective. That's how I got into blues, because I had a guitar teacher give me a bootleg cassette of Jimi Hendrix. And then I'm like, well, where'd he get those licks from? Oh, a buddy guy and guys from beforehand. And you work backwards and you kind of like, you get your whole worldview and it kind of goes in weird circles sometimes. But yeah, yep. I 100%, like, I think maybe that's the next level, is the education part. Like, making sure people know that, like, the people you think are great, they're great, yeah, but they're standing on the shoulders of people who came before them.
Right.
And,
right.
You know, maybe they twisted it, you know, or they stole the idea, but they did something new and they mutated it and gave it to you. You know, it didn't just come out of the blue, you know? It seems obvious now, but it wasn't always so, how like a beat should go, you know, or if there's a formula for this particular kind of music. It didn't happen overnight. It came from experiments and failed efforts and 100 songs to make the one good song.
Yep. Yep. Wow. Yep. Not going to sit down each time and, hey, man, we got one. And just one? Yeah, sometimes that might happen. But you got to record a lot of records to get that.
But you also, you can practice the vibe. You know, the vibe is part of your habits and, you know, of how you create and how often you create and what kind of feeling you create when you create. And that is something that can feed your creativity when you get hungry. You know, that habit, it's already there. You've already kind of put that energy in motion that'll sustain you. Sometimes that gets you in tune when lightning strikes and you dial it in. It is a hit and one or something, you know?
Yep.
Usually the stuff you put the least amount of effort into are the ones that go, oh, you know it right away.
You can overproduce a track and you know, like, oh man, I'm putting my foot in this, and then you give it to an artist and ain't no room for the artist to do nothing to.
Right.
Cause you did so much to this track. But if you'd have just fall back a little bit, don't put a whole lot of effort into making this your greatest work. Like, what you want to be your greatest work is the finished product of everything inclusive.
Just gotta leave it room. Literally leave it room to grow.
You don't want to introduce a finished product to an artist. Like, artist is looking at you like,
where do I fit in? Yeah.
What do I do with this?
Yeah.
You know, Gucci is a prime example of sometimes, man, you can just give him a drum track. Nothing else. Just a drum track. And he had enough vision to write a song to just a drum track. He could hear drums and get excited and wouldn't even give you time to add anything to it. Like, come on, let's record. He'll get whatever he had in his head out, and then you come behind him and add the rest of the song to it. But it makes it work because now he was the first instrument on the song to go along with the drums. Now I don't have to overcrowd it. I know what to do.
You just work around, respond to the energy.
I'm responding to him, and that makes it so much easier, which is another reason why I like creating songs with the artist in the room. Because if you leave me to my own vices, sometimes I'm going to fill it up too much.
Right.
I had to get in the practice of leaving skeletons. So if I need a guitar, it's room for you. The vocalist has room. And those main elements right there, I got some guitar, I got the vocalist. Now if there's anything else it needs, I know what to do with it because Dan did his thing. The artist did their thing. It might be done, or it might be room for a couple of more little bells and whistles, some ear candy to round it out. And then it's done. It's done. You know, so... You know, this the whole process of this thing, man. And again, I guess the theme of this show is trust today. It
should be the theme all the time, I think.
Trust. I mean, trust, man. We don't all these great records were made in trust. You got to trust who you're working with. You got to trust the process. You got to trust everything around this, and that's how it works.
Yeah,
you don't trust the people that you're working with. How can it's like a quarterback. If he doesn't trust his offensive line, and he's always leaving the pocket, he'll never make the big play. He's going to run into a sack. When if he'd have just given his line a little bit of trust. Sit in the pocket and trust the receiver's going to get open.
And just
it's
put
all
it,
trust, man.
Put the ball in front of the receiver and let him do his running.
And let him do his thing.
Right.
Put it in his hands. And once he gets it in his hands, trust that he's going to take the air yards you threw for 10, 15 yards. And he's going to turn those 10, 15 yards into 25, 30. It's all trust. The players have to trust that the coach is going to call the right plays. And when a play comes in, they got to trust that this is going to work. It doesn't work without trust. It doesn't work.
That is one of the universal truths.
And music in our genre, in our field, still don't work without trust. From the studio to the office. Don't work.
Well, I think we got to some pretty deep levels on this one.
It's levels to this, man.
It's levels to this.
We went real deep with this one. Maybe what helped the show get so good today is because of the conversation that I had with an executive before we started filming.
Right, right. Just kind of
because I went into the show still feeling a way. Yeah. I'm feeling a way. You know what I mean? Yeah, yeah, so. And I some of the words that I'm using, I actually use those words in the conversation. You got to trust me, man. Like, trust me. I know what I'm doing, man. You don't have to hold my hands in this creative process. I got some hits. I do have a few hits.
Right.
And you weren't there to hold my hands when I made those. I didn't get any input from you to make those records. So I don't need your input now. And creating music, we don't think music, we feel it. And then we think about it after we've done it. How do we make this do what it do? The part that really gets me the most is it's like, dude, that's just your opinion anyway. You don't think it'll work? Okay. I do. And I'm the creator of it. So how about let's go with what I thought, what I put in it, instead of what you, your opinion. It's like your opinion is making you feel like if we don't do what you want us to do, the record ain't going to work.
Yeah. Well,
I got a number one that they told me wasn't going to work. You know what happened though, Dan?
What happened?
It worked.
What a song about. Want to hear it? Here we go.
It worked. My way. It worked. Everybody was wrong. I was right. I leaked it, so they didn't mess it up. I had to take matters in my own hand. They were going to mess it up. I'm talking about the top executive was wrong. And because everybody kisses ass so much in those offices, every exec under him agreed with him. They were wrong. Some of them ended up losing their jobs because they agreed with the wrong one.
Why didn't you tell me I was wrong? You're fired. It's your job to tell me I'm wrong.
That same exec, the top one that said, told me and Big Ron that it's not a hit, thanked me after it went number one later. Thank you for saving my job. Literally told me that. Let everybody hear. Don't whisper that to me. Tell everybody. I'm not going to expose who that exec was, but tell everybody. We're in the studio. The artist that I gave the number one to, he's right there. My manager's right here. It's a bunch of other people in the room that matter. Say this out loud. Say it out loud. Why are you whispering that to me? Because if you'd have trusted me in the first place, we missed out on a lot of opportunities. The record still went missed number one. But going back and forth about it, we missed out on a lot of sync opportunities, ringtones, at that, all kind of stuff. We missed out on a lot of extra money that we could have made because you don't think it's the number one. And I'm telling you, trust me. If I can listen to my own record a million times, we working with something. I'm not one of those that think everything I do is it. I'm not. That's the first thing I had to learn in this business. Be honest with me. I'm honest with myself. I know when I have something and when I don't. I can be honest with myself. The thinking process comes after we felt our way through some good stuff. Then let's start thinking. We don't want to think a record. It's going to be stale. It's going to be flat. It's going to be too perfect.
It's going to be a copy of the last thing that was a copy of the thing before it. And yeah,
exactly. And that, which is why I love flaws. I love flaws. I don't love mistakes.
Yeah. The flaw means you're reaching. That means you're taking a chance.
Flaws give it character. I love those. If an executive is in the room and hears a flaw, I'm going to tell you to do that over. me as a producer, I'm be like, no, shut up and get out.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he'll never do that again like that, that way. Because he wasn't trying to do that. It just happened. And you get perfect imperfections when you do that.
The thing I always think of when we talk about that kind of topic is like standards of beauty. You know, there's a standard of beauty that implies a certain kind of makeup, sometimes even surgery. There's another standard of beauty that other people have. And the one that always comes to mind is Frida Kahlo. It was the Mexican artist, and she was famous for the
Frida, yeah,
had a different kind of
with the unibrow, yeah.
And it wasn't for everybody, but you know what? That made her unique,
and
timeless, and
uniqueness. Right. There you go.
And maybe there's something to that. So I always think of Frida Kahlo's eyebrows. You know, when that topic comes up, you know, it's like, what do you remember? You know, what stands out? Are you 0.001% better iteration of this other standard has been attempted a billion times? Or are you something else?
Exactly. Exactly. And I err on the side to be something else. Be something else. I can't stand. And if there's any one thing that actually I don't approve of in today's music space is the lack of uniqueness. Everybody is the same. Everybody's the same. And to me, that takes, it leaves me nothing to look forward to. And artists don't take chances on records like they used to. The ones that do take the chances, they're the ones that stay at the tippy top all the time.
They're ahead of the curve.
They stay ahead of the curve. I've always been a trendsetter type. I've never been the follow the trend guy. Never been that. And sometimes I have to tell executives, like, look, you came to me for what I do. Don't come to me and ask me to make a tight beat of somebody else. If you come to me, you're coming to me for what I do. I don't want to make a mustard sounding beat. I don't want to make a metro sounding beat. I don't want to make a type beat. Like, there's artists would pass on a beat when you put their name in it. Like, you know, Rick Ross type beat. And then they hear that and they automatically pass. Why? Because I know you are already giving me something that sound like something I already did. And I'm actually striving for something greater right now. Which is why a lot of producers kind of stay behind the eight ball sometimes, because they're always trying to give somebody a sound that they were already doing. Now, that might work for somebody new that don't mind sounding like somebody else. Find them. But if you're trying to get it to Jay-Z, Rick Ross, Drake, a lot of these artists is like, man, I've already done that. What else you got?
Right.
I'm not trying to do the same song every album. You know, and that just that bothers me in today's music space, man. Everybody's trying to sound like everybody. Why? Stand out. Be different. Be different. Kendrick Lamar stands out. Drake stands out.
It's the people that build their own little universes in their music that stand out.
Stand out.
I think we got some good stuff here. At least
we got some great
five or six shows at least. But Rock With You has many levels.
Many levels, up and down. We got to have a sign out.
It's
levels to this, man.
Actually, there's a C.S. Lewis quote, and it's from the 7th book of Narnia. Is higher up and further in.
Higher up and further in. There you go. All right, Thunder Man. Take care, man.
Be good.
All right.
Hey, it's levels to this.
It's levels to this.
Higher up and further in.
Wow. All
right, there you go. That was a good start off. Okay.
Yeah, that was good.
That's the one. All right, man. We'll see you.
All right, man. Come to fight the turn back.